God forgives us, and what does it mean for us Christians as we go forth into the world and forgive others? We'll consider that here today. May God bless our time together in His Word. We'll sing our opening hymn, 392, Not Unto Us. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Dear friends, let us approach God with a true heart and confess our sins, asking Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. Lord of life, I confess that I am by nature dead in sin, for faithless worrying and selfish pride, for sins of habit and sins of choice, for the evil I have done and the good I have failed to do. You should cast me away from your presence forever. O Lord, I am sorry for my sins. Forgive me for Jesus' sake. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. In His great mercy, God made us alive in Christ, even when we were dead in our sins. Hear the word of Christ through His called servant. I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the well-being of all people everywhere, that they may receive from you all they need to sustain body and life, hear our prayer, O Lord. for the spread of your life-giving gospel throughout the world, that all who are lost in sin may be brought to faith in you. Hear our prayer, O Christ. For patience and perseverance in this life, that we may not lose the hope of heaven as we await your return, hear our prayer, O Lord. Lord of life, live in us that we may live for you. Lord be with you.
And also
with you. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you graciously forgive us all our sins and abundantly provide for all our needs of body and soul. Give us confidence in your mercy and teach us also to be merciful to our neighbor, that we willingly forgive all people and, judging only ourselves, lead blessed lives to your glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. Our Old Testament reading is from the book of Genesis, chapter 50. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "It may be that Joseph will hate us and will pay us back in full for all the evil that we did to him." They sent the following message to Joseph. "Before he died, your father commanded us, 'You are to tell Joseph, please forgive the offense of your brothers and their sin because they did evil to you. Now, please forgive the offense of the servants of the God of your father.'" Joseph wept when they spoke to him. His brothers also came and fell down in front of him, and they said, "See now, we are your servants." Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid, for am I in the place of God? You meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring this to pass and to keep many people alive as it is this day. Now, therefore, do not be afraid. I will nourish you and your little ones." He comforted them and spoke to them in a kind way. The word of the Lord. Our psalm of the day is Psalm 103, which we will sing in unison. Our epistle reading is from St. Paul's epistle to the Ephesians, chapters 4 and 5. Do not let any unwholesome talk come from your mouths. Say only what is beneficial when there is a need to build up others, so that it will be a blessing to those who hear. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of every kind of bitterness, rage, anger, quarreling, and slander, along with every kind of malice. Instead, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving one another, just as God in Christ has forgiven us. Therefore, be imitators of God as his dearly loved children, and walk in love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. The word of the Lord. Please stand. Alleluia. Bear with each other and forgive one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 18. Then Peter came up and asked Jesus, Lord, how many times must I forgive my brother when he sins against me? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, not 7 times, but I tell you, as many as 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. When he began to settle them, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Because the man was not able to pay the debt, his master ordered that he be sold, along with his wife, children, and all that he owned, to repay the debt. Then the servant fell down on his knees in front of him, saying, Master, be patient with me, and I will pay you everything. The master of that servant had pity on him, released him, and forgave him the debt. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. He grabbed him and began choking him, saying, pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down and begged him, saying, be patient with me, and I will pay you back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and threw the man into prison until he could pay back what he owed. When his fellow servants saw what had happened, they were very distressed. They went and reported to their master everything that had taken place. Then his master called him in and said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt when you begged me to. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow servants just as I had mercy on you? His master was angry and handed him over to the jailers until he could pay back everything he owed. This is what my heavenly Father will also do to you, unless each one of you forgives his brother from his heart. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. We'll sing our hymn of the day, hymn 493, Forgive Our Sins as We Forgive.
Thank you.
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ, dear brothers and sisters. In his epistle to the Ephesians, St. Paul dedicates a whole lot of attention to the topic of Christian unity. And when you think about it, this Christian unity that Jesus creates really is quite an astounding thing. Paul speaks about that in his letter as well. In chapters 2 and 3, St. Paul talks about this special thing, this special unity that Jesus created between Jew and Gentiles. And that really was a tremendous thing. Jew and Gentile, they were diametrically opposed to each other. Jew and Gentile were a million miles apart on all of the important issues. Historically, politically, theologically, socially, Jew and Gentile just had nothing in common. Those people groups were just not alike. But in Christ, Jew and Gentile, who were not at all alike, became one. Jesus is still creating this kind of special Christian unity today. All across the Holy Christian Church, in this little corner of the Holy Christian Church that we call Calvary, Jesus is creating special unity between all of us. And think about it. We are people of all different walks of life, different ages. We come from different places, but nonetheless, Jesus has united us as his church into one body with he himself as the head. This unity that Jesus creates is a very special thing. And that's why Paul, in his epistle to the Ephesians, also dedicates a lot of attention to fostering and preserving this Christian unity. In Ephesians 4, verse 29 through 5, verse 2, the words that we heard in our epistle reading, that's Paul's goal in particular, helping us promote and preserve the unity that Jesus creates. Today we're going to consider the words of our epistle reading, and as we do that, we will ask ourselves, how do we as Christians foster and preserve this special unity that Jesus has created among us? And St. Paul's answer to that question is this: imitate God. So then, brothers and sisters, imitate God. Don't let any unwholesome talk come from your mouth. That's how Paul kicks this thing off. There are a whole lot of words that we could say that are just plain useless. Four-letter words, dirty jokes, inappropriate jokes, etc., etc. A lot of things that really aren't helpful, but there are even plenty of neutral words that also really don't serve a good purpose. And Paul says, don't use those words. Don't use those unwholesome words because they are either not helpful or because they are blatantly harmful. So Paul's encouragement, don't use the harmful words. But do understand that even though there are words that are not helpful, there are still plenty of good and useful and beneficial words. There are still plenty of good ways for us to use our tongues. That's what Paul says here. Say only what is beneficial when there is a need to build others up so that it will be a blessing to those who hear. Sometimes your brothers and sisters in Christ will need to hear a word from you. Whether it be a word of correction and admonition, or whether it be a word of comfort and encouragement, or simply a word of instruction. There are a whole bunch of good and useful words that we can say. Christian insights, Christian values, Christian judgments, Christian encouragements, a whole bunch of good and useful words that we can use to help our brothers and sisters when they have need. All of this is to say, let the aim and end of your speech be blessing for others. There are certainly right and wrong ways to use the tongue. We Christians would do well to use our tongue rightly. And this is especially the case given the warning that Paul speaks in verse 30. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God. The prophet Isaiah puts it this way. They rebelled and grieved his Holy Spirit, so the Holy Spirit turned against them. In other words, it is possible for us believers to do things that would damage our relationship to God. So don't do those things that would damage your relationship to God. And specifically in context here, the thing that Paul says would damage your relationship to God is the misuse or the sinful use of your tongue. The tongue can spark a fire that you can't put out. The tongue has been used to hurt countless, countless people throughout the ages. The tongue has been used abusively and harmfully. It can be deadly. And Paul says, don't let that happen. Don't let your tongue become a vessel of sin. If you let that happen, you could provoke the Holy Spirit to leave you. And if the Holy Spirit leaves you, you will be an unbeliever. Think about it this way. Would you want to live in a home, a decrepit home, that's infested with rats and cockroaches? No, you would not. Well, neither does the Holy Spirit. And if we let our bodies, which are temples that the Holy Spirit lives in, if we let those bodies become instruments of sin and wickedness and impenitence, the Spirit might just pack up his bags and go. Yes, God is incredibly patient, but he has set a limit to his patience. And impenitence and sin pushes God's patience to the edge. So don't grieve the Holy Spirit by your actions. But do remember that the Holy Spirit is your friend. In verse 30, the second half of verse 30, Paul says, you were sealed by the Holy Spirit for the day of redemption. The Holy Spirit was sent into your heart to mark you as one of the saved. The indwelling Spirit, he's the guarantee, the deposit, the down payment for your salvation, as Paul explains in Ephesians chapter 1. The Holy Spirit is a special guest who lives within you. He's there to guide you in holiness and purity and Christian living. He's there to preserve you in the faith and to lead you unto life eternal. The Spirit who lives in your heart, he lives in you to help you, to bless you, to keep you. He is your friend. And with his help, by the grace and aid of the Holy Spirit, imitate God. Get rid of every kind of bitterness, rage, anger, quarreling, and slander, along with every kind of malice. Did you catch the progression there? Bitter feelings in the heart give way to rage. Rage gives way to persistent anger. Persistent anger gives way to outbursts of quarreling. And outbursts of quarreling give way to abusive and slanderous words. Indignation and frustration, it starts small and it festers and it grows and grows into something big. And Paul says, don't let that happen. Put it all off. Get rid of that anger before it boils over into something awful. Paul says, put it off. Don't let that be a factor in your interactions with others. Don't let that factor into your interactions with your brothers and sisters in Christ. Put the anger off, Paul says. But maybe you think, no, actually, Paul, I'm justified in feeling the way that I feel because they did me wrong. No, Paul, I'm actually justified in feeling this way because their offense against me was pretty terrible. Well, Paul closes every single loophole that our sinful flesh would look for when he says, get rid of every kind of malice. Malice to any degree, malice in any form, just has no place. No malice. No malice in the life of the Christian. Instead, imitate God. Forgive one another, just as God in Christ has forgiven us. Imitate God in that way. So what if a brother or a sister sins against me? What if their sin against me is that great? You have Paul's answer. forgive as God forgives? What does it mean that God forgives? How does God forgive? This is how God forgives. Romans 5, verse 1. Since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God. God has removed any and all animosity that existed between himself and the offending party. How does God forgive? Matthew 18, verse 22. Forgive not 7 times, but 77 times. You have surely heard of giving a second chance, but have you ever heard of giving a 77th chance? That's what God gives. Essentially, God's forgiveness is unlimited. He always, always, always forgives the penitent. When they come to him looking for forgiveness and faith, he always does it. How does God forgive? Jeremiah 31, verse 34. Their sin, I will remember no more. God doesn't bring past and previous and prior sin into the picture. He simply lets it go. No animosity. No limits. No recalling. That is how God forgives. So then, brothers and sisters, forgive as God forgives. Now, that does not mean that we don't expect changed behavior on the part of the penitent. Produce fruits in keeping with repentance is John the Baptist's instruction, after all. So a thief who feels guilty about his thievery ought to return the things that he stole. That would be an example of a fruit of repentance. Forgive as God forgives. And no, that does not mean that there won't be earthly consequences for the penitent going forward. The thief on the cross did go to be with Jesus in paradise. But the thief on the cross did not get to come down from the cross and continue to live his life on earth. Yes, we do expect repentance. We expect fruits of repentance. We expect change. We do expect sanctified living for our brothers and sisters and for ourselves as well, just as God has those expectations. And part of living those sanctified lives is forgiving each other just as God has forgiven us in Christ. No animosity, no limits, no recalling. That's how we have been forgiven. And that's what God wants us to turn around and do in the world as well. And consider this related point as well. Our debt of sin was so offensive, so great, so foul, so filthy. It was so abhorrent to God that only the death of God could rightly deal with it. Well, God died. God died. And our debt of sin, worth 10,000 talents, according to the gospel reading. And by the way, 10,000 talents would be worth about $3.5 billion dollars today. That massive, massive debt was forgiven us fully and completely in the blood of Christ. And since that is so, can't we then, brothers and sisters, go forth and forgive people when they sin against us? Even though their debt against us may only be worth 100 denarii, a few thousand dollars in today's money, can't we forgive them? This is certainly within the realm of possibility for us Christians. It's in the realm of possibility for us Christians if only we look to God for guidance and strength. Therefore, brothers and sisters, be imitators of God as his dearly loved children. Imitate God. Do that by remembering who you are. You are God's dearly loved child. Paul has really hammered that point home for us in Ephesians as well, right? He can't stop talking about the amazing grace of God in this letter. He reminds us exactly who we are, exactly how we stand, exactly how God views us. Already at the beginning, he says, you were chosen in Christ before the foundations of the earth were laid. You were marked for redemption. Jesus is ruling the universe right now for you. Jesus made you alive even when you were dead in transgressions and sins. Jesus reconciled you to God through his blood. Jesus presents you before himself as holy and blameless in his sight. You are God's dear child, most precious and deeply loved by him. You are indeed a member of that family. You are indeed a child of God. So be imitators of God as the dear children that you are. Like father, like son, they often say. Have you ever seen a little boy playing with toy hammers and toy saws and things like that? That little boy does that because he wants to be just like his father who uses those tools. Have you ever seen a little girl playing with a dollhouse? The little girl does that because she wants to be just like her mother who cares for those in her household. Be just like those little children. Be imitators of our Father in heaven. Imitate his forgiveness. Imitate his mercy. Imitate his forgiveness and mercy that know no limits. St. Paul here in Ephesians 4 and 5, he's got one final concluding remark for us. One last remark to kind of summarize everything that he said. It's this: walk in love just as Christ loved us and gave himself for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Have this mindset, brothers and sisters. I will offer myself in service to others. I will conduct myself in a loving way towards my brothers and sisters in Christ. And one final time here, St. Paul reminds us how we can do that. Imitate God. Follow the example that God set. Follow the model that God set. Consider his love. God's love for us is not a superficial love. His love for us is not a love that gives chocolates and roses and writes love letters or anything like that. God's love for us is a love that willingly gave itself into death for us. Do not think that the cross of Christ was an unfortunate circumstance. Do not think that the cross of Christ was a necessary evil. Jesus wanted to take up our sins. Jesus wanted to suffer and die on our behalf. He was a very willing participant in his execution. That's what he wanted to do because he loved us, and he knew that's what it would take to forgive us. And of course, the loving, willing death that Christ died on Calvary, it has appeased God. In the Old Testament times, bulls and all kinds of other animals were slaughtered, and then they were burnt up on the altar, and the aroma of that burnt offering would reach heavens and appease God. In the same way, the sacrificial death of Christ appeases God as well. The scent of Christ's death on the cross has penetrated the heavens. It has reached the throne of God the Father Almighty, and it truly has satisfied God's wrath over our sin. That's how God loved us. Walk in love. And if you want to know what that means or what that looks like, just look at God. Look at what God does in Christ. We were an unworthy and undeserving lot, but God loved us. His faithfulness to a faithless world was that great and that enduring. And God gave his only begotten Son so that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. And thus God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. God was in Christ reconciling you and me to himself. That is what love means. That is what love looks like. So brothers and sisters, imitate that love of God in Christ Jesus. And know this too. This love of God that we imitate, the example that we find in the gospel of Christ, this model that God set for us, it is so much more than a model. It is so much more than a guidebook or an instruction manual. This love of God that we model, sacrificial, self-giving love that we model, that love itself truly and really is our forgiveness. That death and resurrection of Jesus really and truly is our power for Christian and godly living. And our faithful God, He will strengthen you and support you as you leave this place and go live your Christian life in the world. Our God will sanctify you completely, spirit, soul, and body, so that you may live a life worthy of your calling. Dear saints of God, the unity that Jesus creates amongst Christians really is an astounding thing. Jesus has united all of us in the faith, making all of us brothers and sisters here. All of us here are dear children of God the Father. All of us here are siblings of our Savior and our brother Jesus. Yes, the unity that God creates really is a special thing. Let us strive to foster and preserve that Christian unity. How shall we do that? We'll do it by putting away unwholesome and useless words, and instead by speaking to build each other up. How will we preserve our unity? By not letting anger and frustration stew and brew. How will we preserve and promote our Christian unity? By forgiving each other from the heart, just as God in Christ has forgiven us. How shall we promote and preserve and foster this blessed and beautiful Christian unity that God has created in this place? We'll do that by imitating God. God grant it. Amen. Please stand. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We join to confess our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. Who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. Now gather our offering. Please stand. Almighty and most merciful God, we give you thanks for all your tender mercies, especially for your dear Son, and for the revelation of your will and grace. We ask you to implant your word in us, so that with good and honest hearts we may keep it and bring forth fruit in Christian living. We ask you to so rule and govern your church with its pastors and ministers, that we may be preserved in the pure doctrine of your saving word, with which you strengthen our faith, increase our love, and extend your kingdom. Send forth laborers into your harvest field, and sustain those whom you have sent, so that the word of reconciliation may be proclaimed to all people, and the gospel preached in all the world. Grant also health and prosperity to all that are in authority, to the President and Congress of the United States, to the governor and legislature of this state, and to all our judges and magistrates. Give them grace to rule after your good pleasure, and to maintain good order in society, so that we may live in quietness and peace. To all who are in trouble, have need, are sick, in peril of death, or in any adversity, grant comfort with your Holy Spirit, so that they may receive and acknowledge their afflictions as the manifestations of your fatherly will. Cause all needful fruits of the earth to prosper, so that we may enjoy them in due season. Give success to the training of the young, to all lawful occupations on land and sea, and to all pure arts and useful knowledge, and crown them with your blessing. Hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. These and whatever other things you would have us ask of you, O God, grant to us for the sake of the bitter sufferings and death of Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is good and right so to do.
It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who called us to be his own, so that we may live under him in his kingdom and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join in their glorious song. Blessed are you, O Lord of heaven and earth. We praise and thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ. And we remember the great acts of love through which he has ransomed us from sin, death, and the devil's power. By his incarnation, he became one with us. By his perfect life, he fulfilled your holy will. By his innocent death, he overcame hell. By his rising from the grave, he opened heaven. Invited by your grace and instructed by your word, we approach your table with repentant and joyful hearts. Strengthen us through Christ's body and blood, and preserve in us the true faith until we feast with him and all his ransomed people in glory everlasting.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please stand. We give you thanks, O Lord, for the foretaste of the heavenly banquet that you have given us to eat and to drink in this sacrament. Through this gift, you have fed our faith, nourished our hope, and strengthened our love. By your Spirit, help us to live as your holy people until that day when you will receive us as your guests at the wedding supper of the Lamb, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated. We'll sing our closing hymn. Once again, good morning to you all. It was so great to gather together with all of you as God's people, as brothers and sisters, to hear and proclaim God's word with all of you and to receive the sacrament with all of you as well. I do not have anything special to announce at this point, but it may very well be possible that there is something I should say, so to the floor. That's coming. We'll get there. God be with you all till we meet again.